Thank you. Can I welcome everyone to the 35th meeting of the Justice Committee in 2015? Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices as they interfere with broadcasting, even when they're switched to silent? No apologies have been received. Before I move on to the items of business, a comment I want to make is about late papers. This committee is a very busy committee. It has a huge amount of work, has a stage 3 debate this afternoon on a justice bill, and yet we receive papers on a Monday, sometimes on a Tuesday morning. I appreciate in some circumstances there may be reasons why they've come late. Somebody's ill, hasn't managed to send in something, but it is becoming a regular habit. And I want to say to those who do submit late papers, we don't have time to read them most of the time and do them any justice. It cannot be looked at on a Monday night or Tuesday morning. And accordingly, often they're too late and they are a waste of your time and a waste of our time. So if I just put that in the record so that we don't have an epidemic of late papers from now on. And now move on to item one in the business. The committee is invited to agree to consider item 9 in private. This is a discussion on our approach to next week's public evidence session and intercepts of communications by Police Scotland. Are members agreed we take this in private?
Yep.
Thank you very much. Item 2 is the Apologies Scotland Bill. We now move on to stage 2 proceedings on the Apologies Scotland Bill. Members should have their copies of the bill, the marshalled list and groupings of amendments for today's consideration. I welcome Margaret Mitchell, member in charge of the bill, and Scottish Parliament officials. Also welcome Paul Wheelhouse, Minister of Community Safety and Legal Affairs, and his officials. And of course, this is not an evidence session, so the officials are not here to answer any questions, just to give moral support where required. I now move on to the amendments. The question is that section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yep.
Call amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments 3 to 9. Minister, please, to move amendment 2 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. The amendments in this group reflect the need to ensure the bill does not have unintended consequences. As the committee will be aware, I have expressed concerns regarding the potential of restricting access to justice for pursuers and how it would interact with other legislation. Based on further discussions with the member and further work, including engagement with the legal profession and listening to the views of key stakeholders, including the views of survivors, which have been of a concern to all of us, I'm now satisfied that if the bill is amended, as Margaret Mitchell and I are proposing today, it would strike an appropriate balance between promoting apologies and minimising its unintended consequences. The amendments in this group are key to striking this balance, along with the amendments to the definition in Section 3. Amendment 3 accepts inquiries, including joint inquiries, which the Scottish Ministers caused to be held under Section 1 of the Inquiries Act 2005, or which convert under Section 15 of that Act into inquiries under that Act. The rationale for this amendment is the same as Margaret Mitchell provided for excluding fatal accident inquiries from the scope of the bill. As Ms Mitchell clearly outlined in the policy memorandum to the bill, and I quote, inquiries take account of the public interest in ensuring that all relevant evidence may be led, unquote. An inquiry is not about liability. It aims to provide a complete picture of what has happened. The same reasoning can be applied to public inquiries in Scotland. It is for the inquiry chair to determine what information is relevant to the inquiry and examine that information to inform the recommendations and conclusions. In this context, the giving of an apology is likely to be a pertinent piece of information, and the ability of the inquiry chair to consider this should not be restricted by this bill. This applies even if the bill is amended to remove fact and fault from the definition of apology, since information regarding whether a simple apology was made may be in the public interest. When an independent public inquiry is established, it is often to ascertain what happened and why, and identify what can be done to prevent such an event happening again. In this context, the giving of undertakings is often critical to the considerations of an inquiry chair. Undertakings form part of the definition of an apology under this bill and would therefore be inadmissible as evidence in the inquiry. This information may influence any recommendations resulting from an inquiry, and it is therefore important that this bill does not limit the information the inquiry can draw upon in this regard. Amendment 4 excludes proceedings under the Children's Hearings Scotland Act 2011, or the 2011 Act, from the scope of the bill. This would exempt proceedings either before a court or a children's hearing from the scope of the bill. As you may recall, in their written evidence to the committee, the Scottish Children's Reporters Administration, or SCRA, strongly urged the committee to exclude proceedings under the 2011 Act from the scope of the bill. They stated that, and I quote, if children's hearing court proceedings were not excluded from the bill's scope, there would be potentially significant consequences for the children's hearing system in relation to both child protection and youth justice concerns, unquote. They shared examples referring to an adult apologising during a police interview and an apology made by a child for committing an offence. If proceedings under the 2011 Act were not excluded from the bill's scope, these apologies may not be available as evidence to establish grounds of referral. This might remove the legal basis to bring a child before a children's hearing or for a court to establish these grounds of referral, and therefore the ability to impose appropriate measures of supervision and protection. This could have a direct impact on the children's hearing system in Scotland. SCRA has also made the point that when it comes to children committing offences, this is dealt with through a civil procedure. However, the standard of proof is, and I quote, beyond reasonable doubt, unquote. They are of the view that for the same reason as criminal proceedings are excluded from the bill's scope, so should proceedings relating to offence grounds of referral under the 2011 Act be excluded. SCRA has written to the committee and confirmed that they remain of the view that proceedings under the 2011 Act should be removed from the scope of the bill, even if admissions of fault and statements of fact are removed from the definition of apologies. Amendment 6 excludes apologies given in the context of the duty of candour procedure under the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill from the scope of the bill. As the duty of candour procedure is not itself a form of civil proceedings, the amendment creates a new subsection 1A. The effect of this amendment is to remove apologies made in the context of the duty of candour procedure from the scope of the Apologies Bill. And as was discussed in the course of the Stage 1 evidence session and in the Stage 1 report, the reason for the amendment is to remove any the inconsistency that exists between the Apologies Bill and the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill, Health Bill, in terms of how apologies are treated as evidence. An apology made in the context of the duty of candour procedure does not of itself amount to an admission of negligence or a breach of a statutory duty. This bill would sit at odds with the targeted legislation on the duty of candour procedure in the Health Bill, and therefore it should be exempted from the scope of the Apologies Bill. I understand Ms Mitchell has been persuaded that there is a need to make this exemption. Amendment 2 is a technical amendment to remove any ambiguity that may be created by the inclusion of the examples of proceedings provided in the brackets. I understand from Ms Mitchell that the wording in brackets was intended to provide clarity by indicating what types of proceedings would be covered by the bill. In my view, the inclusion of a non-exhaustive list of proceedings creates ambiguity and is unnecessary. Moreover, as noted earlier, in relation to Amendment 3, I'm seeking to exempt inquiries from the scope of the bill, which is currently one of the categories of proceedings provided for in the brackets. As noted in the explanatory notes to the bill, all civil proceedings are covered, subject to the exceptions set out in Section 2. On the basis that civil proceedings for the purposes of this legislation simply means legal proceedings that are not criminal, there would not be, appear to be a need to set out some examples of proceedings covered. Amendment 5 is a technical amendment which replaces the reference to the 1976 Act with the more recent inquiries into fatal accident and sudden deaths, etc. Scotland Act 2016, which has passed Stage 1. Amendment 7 is also a technical amendment which removes subsection 2 of Section 2. This section is unnecessary since it is already clear that the bill applies only to civil proceedings. By removing superfluous information, this amendment provides clarity. Amendments 8 and 9 are technical amendments which extend the power of Scottish ministers to modify the exceptions to include modifying new subsection 1A created by Amendment 6. And this amendment does not otherwise extend the Scottish minister's power under Section 2, subsection 3, to make exceptions by way of regulations. I move Amendment 2.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to speak? Yes, Gavin.
I'm assuming the minister gets an opportunity to wind up. My only question is in relation to Amendment 7, Minister. My question is, are there any downsides to retaining Section 2, subsection 2? Because for me, the upside in retention seems to be that it gives absolute clarity and it gives simplicity on the face of the bill. Your explanation was that removing that section would provide clarity, but actually I think it could be argued that retaining it, it provides greater clarity. So my only question is, are there any downsides to retaining it? And I simply leave that out there, and perhaps he's allowed to address that when he closes.
It was about Amendment 3, which refers to the Inquiries Act 2005, which is a piece of UK legislation and specifies inquiries which may be set up by certain ministers, including UK ministers, who obviously would not be subject to this legislation. But it also refers to Scottish ministers and Welsh ministers and so on. In terms of inquiries set up by a Scottish minister, would this not then refer to, would this legislation be excluded from, being applicable to the inquiries set up under that legislation, but by a Scottish minister.
Rod.
My register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates, but I just really wanted to support the comments of my colleague Gavin Brown on that issue as to 2-2. I'm grateful for the Minister's comments.
Right. Before I come to Minister, Margaret.
Thank you, Convener, and I'd like to take this opportunity to sincerely thank the Minister and his officials for working constructively with me to reach a stage where we will have an amended bill which hopefully in the main meets the aims we both want to achieve. Section 2 of the bill sets out the legal proceedings covered by the bill. Essentially, it applies to all civil proceedings subject to two exemptions, namely defamation and fatal accident inquiries, and Amendment 5 updates the reference to the most recent FAI legislation. During Stage 1 consideration of the bill, it became apparent that there were a number of additional areas where witnesses and respondents felt that the exception should be extended to include other types of proceedings. And I indicated at that time that I would be open to considering other exceptions where the case could be made for their inclusion. So taking each of these in turn, Amendment 3 relates to the Minister's proposed extension to the original number of exemptions to include inquiries under specified provisions in the 2005 Inquiries Act. It's my understanding the argument in favour of this is that these inquiries are held to establish the facts, not for any probative value, and the Minister has advanced the argument that apologies should therefore be included in order to ensure such proceedings are not undermined. I confirm I accept this. However,
Lynn Murray now understands, so you've got
it
there.
My question,
all right, thank you.
Right.
However, I would welcome the Minister's clarification of the intention behind this imposed exception. In particular, I should be grateful if the Minister would give his views and assurances on how the exemption would operate in terms of the historic child abuse inquiry. As the Minister will be aware, one of my key reasons for bringing the bill forward in the first place stems from my work with the cross-party group and adult survivors of childhood sexual abuse, and the recognition of the benefits of an apology being given without the fear of it being used as a basis for establishing legal liability. Amendment 4 exempts proceedings under the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011, and having had discussions with representatives from the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration, I recognise that these hearings are complex in nature and are established for a range of purposes, some of which have been covered by the Minister this morning. I am therefore persuaded that the court proceedings under the Children's Hearings Scotland Act 2011 should be added to the exemptions to the Bill's application. Amendment 6 provides that new legislation is not to apply to an apology under the duty of candour procedure in the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill. Here, a different approach to an apology is to be legislated for, namely that an apology made under the duty of candour procedure contained in the Health Bill will not in itself amount to an admission of negligence or breach of statutory duty, but would be admissible and could be founded on in legal proceedings. Whilst I have reservations about how successful making an apology admissible here would be, I recognise that the government's intention is to proceed in this way. And as the Justice Committee in its Stage 1 report stated, it's difficult to see how the bill and the duty of candour provisions could coexist without some form of exception. I agree, and hence I'm also content with this exception. The other amendments, 2, 5, 8 and 9 in this group, are in the main consequential amendments as a result of those exceptions or tidy-up technical amendments. It is to be hoped, as the bill is established, that the number of exceptions could be kept to a minimum in an effort to ensure that it remains as straightforward as possible. Some may even be removed using the power to do so within Section 2.3, which allows Scottish ministers to modify exemptions to the bill by means of regulation sometime in the future, clearly. I note the Amendment 7 removes the reference to criminal proceedings. This is a provision which was included in the Bill for the avoidance of doubt, and to make it absolutely clear that the Bill does not apply to such proceedings. I fully appreciate the Scottish Government's position that Section 2.2 is unnecessary and is not essential to set this out on the face of the Bill. However, as the provision is currently in the Bill, it may cause confusion to remove it. And so I wonder if there would be any harm in allowing it to remain there. At the very least, it would certainly be helpful to have confirmation on the record that there is no intention to cast doubt on the non-application of the Act to criminal proceedings. In conclusion, convener, I confirm that I'm content with Amendments 2 to 6 and 8 and 9.
Thank you very much. Minister, to wind up, please.
Thank you, convener. If I can start with Amendment 7, I've listened to the points made by Gavin Brown, Roderick Campbell, and indeed Margaret Mitchell, and I'm happy to not move Amendment 7 if that makes members more confident about the clarity of the bill. As regards Amendment 3, I just in response to both Dr. Murray's point and just Margaret Mitchell's response, just to say this amendment accepts inquiries, including joint inquiries, which Scottish ministers cause to be held under Section 1 of the Inquiries Act 2005, or which they convert under Section 15 of that Act into inquiries under that Act. The purpose is to exclude inquiries held by Scottish ministers under Section 1 of the 2005 Act, converted under Section 15 of the 2005 Act, or held jointly by two or more ministers, where the Scottish ministers are one party, from the application of the legislation. And so the effect of that is that an apology given in the context of an inquiry, or a joint inquiry indeed, which the Scottish ministers cause to be held under Section 1 of the 2005 Act, or which they convert into inquiries under the Section 15 of the 2005 Act, would be admissible as evidence in these proceedings. I hope that helps just put on the record our understanding of what the amendment would mean in practice. And I just want to address the point that Margaret Mitchell made regarding Amendment 2, and I appreciate this is something of great interest to Margaret Mitchell, who's had a long-standing interest in these issues. I understand the importance to many survivors of historic child abuse of hearing an apology. I've heard testimony to that effect myself. But as set out in Section 2, Subsection 1 of the Inquiries Act 2005, and I quote here, an inquiry panel is not to rule on and it has no power to determine any person's civil or criminal liability, unquote. Instead, it is, as members will know, a fact-finding exercise to establish a full picture of events which have caused public concern. The aim of inquiries is to help to restore public confidence in systems or services by investigating the facts and making recommendations to prevent reoccurrence, not to establish liability or to punish anyone. And part of that function may include the hearing of an apology and an associated undertaking, which may demonstrate that a person or a company has shown insight into past failings and taken steps to prevent a recurrence. I'm not of the view that it would be in the public interest to prevent such evidence being heard in the context of a public inquiry. Not exempting inquiries from the scope of the bill would limit the independence of the inquiry to make its own decisions of what is in the public interest and what can be used as evidence. So the bill would still prevent the simple apology being used in the civil courts as evidence of liability. And for these reasons, I'm of the view the amendment is necessary at this point.
Thank you very much. Question is, amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Now I'm going to call amendments 3 to 6 because the Minister has indicated he doesn't wish to move amendment 7. So I'm going to call amendments 3 to 6, all the Minister and all previously debated, and I invite the Ministers to move amendments 3 to 6 en bloc.
Only moved, Camilla.
Does any member object to a question be put on amendments 3 to 6? Single question, you don't. The question is, amendments 3 to 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
I call Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister.
Not moved, Convener.
I now call Amendments 8 and 9 in the name of the Minister and invite the Minister to move those two amendments en bloc.
Formally moved, Convener.
Does any member object to a single question we put on 8 and 9? Thank you. The question is Amendments 8 and 9 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 10 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendment 1. Minister, please, to move Amendment 10 and speak to both amendments.
Thank you, Convener. As discussed at Stage 1 and as is reflected in the Stage 1 report, there has been an overriding concern that the benefit of hearing an apology may be outweighed by the inability to use this as evidence in any civil proceedings. In particular, the committee noted in the Stage 1 report that, and I quote, the definition of apologies must be reconsidered, unquote. I've reflected on the evidence at Stage 1, and my officials and I have undertaken further work to try to ascertain whether, by removing fact and fault from the definition, this would alleviate concerns about any potential injustice to pursuers. I am of the view that Amendment 10 is necessary to remove fault from the definition of apology, because in our largely common law-based adversarial system, it's a matter for courts to determine liability and action for damages. Making expressed or implied admissions of fault inadmissible because they are preceded with an expression of regret would not strike an appropriate balance. Some other jurisdictions, including New South Wales, in whose legislation I understand this bill has been based, have largely replaced the common law of negligence with statutory no-fault compensation schemes. In such a context, apologies legislation doesn't present the same challenges when fault is not at issue. Apologising for causing injury isn't putting the person who caused the injury in a worse position. As I have noted, in largely common law-based adversarial system, if admissions of fault are not admissible as evidence, this would present concerns about access to justice for pursuers. And this was clear from evidence from the Faculty of Advocates and the Association for Personal Injury Lawyers, or APPL, at Stage 1. In particular, Mr. Ronald Conway of APPL explained that the first thing that any justice system has to do is get at the truth. It has to find the factual matrix and then apply the law to it, unquote. If admissions of fault were retained in the definition of an apology, this would remove, in his words, and I quote, an extremely powerful and persuasive piece of evidence, unquote. The example he provided was in respect of a road traffic accident, but there are other scenarios where injustice could arise in cases where admission of fault is the only means of demonstrating liability for the harm caused. A pursuer would be unable to succeed in action for damages if fault remains as part of the definition. As I explained to committee, one of my main concerns was in respect of evidential hurdles that survivors of historic child abuse can face when seeking to progress a court action. Preventing the use of an admission of fault in the way proposed in the bill as introduced could add to their evidential burdens. And for these reasons, I remain of the view that retaining admissions of fault within the definition of an apology would present a real risk of causing injustice to pursuers. The effect of making admission of fault inadmissible would be to take away from people rights they currently have, as we heard in the course of evidence at Stage 1. Convener, I note that in Stage 1 report you made it clear that the committee must be reassured that individuals wishing to pursue fair claims are not going to be disadvantaged by the measures of the bill. In an effort to work constructively with the member, I have undertaken further inquiries as to the impact of protecting a simple apology, which is what you get if the definition currently in the bill is amended to remove fault and fact. I have listened to stakeholders and am persuaded that if the definition is amended to remove fault and fact, and the necessary exceptions are provided for in Section 2, the access to justice concerns previously raised are capable of being addressed. I trust Amendment 10 and Amendment 1, if agreed, will provide the committee with sufficient reassurance that the access to justice concerns voiced during Stage 1 are addressed. I should make clear at this stage that along with Amendment 1 to remove statements of fact from the definition, Amendment 10 is key to my continued support for Margaret Mitchell's bill. I move Amendment 10 and support Amendment 1.
Thank you very much. Margaret, please, to speak to Amendment 1, please.
Section 3 of the bill sets out the definition of an apology. As it currently stands, that definition is a broad one. This was to set out the fullest possible apology. So included within the apology could be an admission of fault, statements of fact, or an undertaking to look at the circumstances giving rise to the incident to which the apology relates. Whilst all these elements are protected from being admissible in proceedings to which the bill applies, I fully expected these provisions to be tested during the committee's scrutiny of the bill. In particular, I recognise that the inclusion of statements of fact in the definition goes much further than any other apologies legislation, the argument for its inclusion being there is virtually always another way to prove these facts if necessary. However, I fully accept that there may be occasions when the statement of fact itself within an apology might be the only evidence available. So during the Stage 1 debate, I confirmed that I was persuaded that the definition of the bill could be revised to remove the reference currently contained in it to statements of fact. Amendment 1 addresses this point. Amendment 10 removes the elements of admission of fault from the Bill's protection and addresses the Minister's concerns that the Bill, as currently drafted, could have the unintended consequences of causing injustice to some pursuers. Here I've argued that to admit fault, whether or not you are actually at fault, is a natural thing to do in the context of giving an apology. Furthermore, that an admission of fault is not the same as an admission of liability, let alone an admission of negligence. However, I accept that this is a legal distinction and that the Minister and many others who gave evidence were not persuaded that this should be included in the definition. I previously indicated I was open to being persuaded that the removal of fault is what is required to address the fears expressed at stage one. I now confirm that I recognise this to be the case and that I am therefore content with Amendment 10. The definition of an apology within the Bill is, of course, an essential element. The only remaining element beyond a simple apology is a commitment to review, and this will still go some considerable way towards giving closure to the recipient and giving the apologiser the encouragement to make a more meaningful apology in the first place.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to? Roddy.
Convener, I listened to what both the Minister and Margaret said, and I think the Minister is wise to have taken on board the comments not only of Mr. Conway of Apple, but also the Forum of Insurance Lawyers, and indeed my own Faculty of Advocates. I have to say, I think the proposed amendments are the right way forward, but I'm personally not fully persuaded that leaving in paragraph 3C is appropriate, but that's obviously not part of an amendment today, so I just put that on the record.
Any other members? Minister, please, to wind up.
Convener, I'm happy to leave it at that. I note Mr. Campbell's concern, but I believe we've struck a fair compromise, which hopefully will deliver the culture change that the member is seeking through her bill, but also protect the victims of abuse and other individuals who need to take forward a case from any access to justice concerns.
Thank you very much. The question is Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 1, the name of Margaret Mitchell. Ready to debate Amendment 10. Margaret, to move or not move?
Formally moved.
The question is Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Question is that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 11 in the name of the Minister and a group in its own. Minister, please, to move and speak to Amendment 11.
Convener, this amendment changes the commencement of the Act from a fixed period at the end of the period of 6 months beginning with the day of Royal Assent to commencement by way of regulations. This amendment is in line with Scottish Government policy. This will allow flexibility with regards to when the Act is commenced. This may be important if the Scottish Ministers consider making regulations under Section 2, Subsection 3, and given that parliamentary recess commences on 24th of March, it's important that sufficient time is provided to enable parliamentary scrutiny of any such regulations. Given the collaborative manner in which I have been working with Ms. Mitchell, I trust that she will be content to work constructively to commence the bill by way of regulations. And I move Amendment 11.
March, any other member wish to speak? Margaret, do you wish to?
Convener, as it currently stands, new legislation will come fully into force automatically in 6 months from Royal Assent. Amendment 11 provides for the Act to come into force by regulations on a date to be appointed by Scottish Ministers. I note what the Minister says and look forward to working with him, but I should greatly appreciate, if possible, a commitment from him that the whole Act will come into force within 6 months of Royal Assent, and if not, no later than a year after Royal Assent.
I think I'll just leave the two of you to agree things. You're getting on so well, this collaborative, smiley approach that's going on. Minister, would you respond
I can assure
the
member.
Smiling again, you see.
I can assure the member that if I am here in a year's time, I would hope that the legislation has been implemented. but certainly we have worked collaboratively, convener, on this issue. I hope it's just a matter of practicalities around the parliamentary recess to avoid any clash with that we're seeking to avoid. I don't have a strict timetable, but I take the member's point, and we want to see this culture change as soon as possible.
Thank you very much. The question is Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Questions at Section 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Questions at Section 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Agreed? The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That ends stage 2 consideration of the bill. Thank you very much. I thank the member in charge, Margaret Mitchell. It's a successful outing for you, Margaret, and the minister. And I'm sure you've got more happy little meetings ahead because it seems to be going swimmingly. Thank you very much. I'll suspend briefly to allow officials to switch over. Moving on to item 3, consideration of a first affirmative instrument today, the Draft Victims' Rights Scotland Regulations 2015. And remaining with us is Paul Wheelhouse, Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs. He now has with him Neil Robertson, EU Criminal Justice Team, Graham Ackerman, Victims and Witnesses Team, and Craig McGuffie, Directorate for Legal Services. Good morning to all. I remind you that this is an evidence session so that if the Minister wishes, the officials can take part in this item, but not in the formal debate that follows. And the same applies when we come to the next affirmative instrument. But I know you all know this now, so I shouldn't really teach my granny to suck eggs. I put on the record that because this instrument seeks to transpose an EU directive on victims' rights and appears to create substantive new rights and obligations, the committee issued a targeted call for evidence on it. We're grateful to those who responded, and those responses which have been published on our website will help inform our evidence-taking session today. And I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement, please.
Thank you, Convener. The Victims' Rights Scotland Regulations 2015 will, in conjunction with the order, which will also be considered by the committee this morning, complete our transposition of Directive 2012/29/EU, commonly known as the Victims' Rights Directive. The directive establishes minimum standards on the rights, support and protection of victims of crime. It seeks to ensure that all victims of crime receive appropriate protection and support, can participate in criminal proceedings in accordance with national law, and are recognised and treated in a respectful, sensitive and professional manner. The Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014 goes some way to fulfilling the directive's requirements. However, further provision is required to fully implement the directive, and let me explain why. When the Victims and Witnesses Bill was developed, our focus was on certain key areas of the directive which required new procedures or extensive changes to existing procedures. For example, giving victims a right to certain information, giving certain individuals a right to choose the gender of their police interviewer, and making extensive changes to the procedures whereby special measures are made available to vulnerable witnesses. We were aware that further work to ensure full transposition of the directive would be required, but at the time we considered that this could largely be taken forward on a non-statutory basis. Many of the directive requirements are already delivered operationally, such as the right to interpretation and translation, and we were keen not to legislate unnecessarily. However, following the passage of the bill, the European Commission published guidance. And this guidance, referenced in the evidence provided by Scottish Women's Aid, outlines the approach it expects member states to take in transposing the directive. The guidance suggests that a specific legal framework encompassing all the directive requirements and enabling individuals to clearly recognise their rights and obligations be put in place. In light of this, we came to the view that putting the remaining directive requirements on a statutory footing is necessary and taking into account the Commission's view on clearly setting out victims' rights desirable. Together with the existing provisions of the 2014 Act and the order to be considered shortly, the regulations achieve this purpose. They do this by amending the 2014 Act to extend the rights of victims of crime by creating enforceable rights and by placing obligations on competent authorities, such as the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and Police Scotland. As indicated in the evidence provided to the committee by the Faculty of Advocates, many of these rights are already delivered in practice. For example, the regulations give a victim the right to interpretation and translation, something that is already routinely provided by the competent authorities. In addition, the regulations make provision for the Scottish ministers to publish an information booklet known as the Victims Code for Scotland, which will be published the day on the regulations come into force, and this is the finalised draft, convener. We have produced this in collaboration with criminal justice agencies and in consultation with victims' rights groups. The code provides important information for victims on their rights under the amended 2014 Act, and how those...
Minister, you held something up there. Can I just go back to that?
It's just that we have not yet published it, convener, so apologies if you have not yet seen this.
When will we be seeing this?
I believe it's in about 3 weeks' time, is it correct? About 3 weeks' time, convener, once the regulations are in place. The code also signed... We didn't want to be presumptive by publishing, obviously, before the regulations are passed. Yeah. The code also signposts victims to the relevant authorities who can give them further help, support and advice. As the introduction to the code states, and I quote just to aid the committee's understanding, by ensuring victims' interests remain at the heart of our criminal justice system, victims should feel supported and informed at every stage of the process. The intention, therefore, is for this to be a living document subject to regular review. For example, we have already discussed the creation of a child-friendly version with Children First and other aspects of the code through the victims' organisations Collaborative Forum Scotland. It goes without saying that the Scottish Government is committed to strengthening the rights and protection of victims. Our record backs this up, we believe. We believe that the regulations will enhance those rights and that protection, and I look forward to taking the committee's questions, convener.
Thank you very much. Roddy, John, Margaret. Yes?
Yeah, thank you, convener. Minister, we've had some representations from children's organisations in particular that if we're going to have a draft victims code, it should be child friendly. Would you like to comment on that? And there's also an additional point on the question of the use of intermediaries, which perhaps you might also want to comment on as well.
Well, certainly on the first point, we have had some discussions with, as I said in opening remarks, with Children's First on the full version, which will mainly be used by adults, I'm supposing, convener, will be itself simple, we hope, to read and to understand. But we want to obviously allow for the fact that we have to cater for the needs of children who obviously sadly present as victims of crime all too often, and to ensure that they have a version which is easy for them to understand and to absorb their and to feel comforted that they have the support they need. I just wonder whether I might be able to bring in, I think Graham Ackerman may be able to give more detail on the discussions we've had with Children's First convener, which made the members' understanding on that point, and then I'll return to the issue of intermediaries.
Absolutely. In putting together the draft Victims Code, we've had extensive conversations with Children First, Scottish Women's Aid, Victims Support Scotland and others, as the Minister says. Clearly, we want to make sure the code is as accessible as possible and can be read by people and understood. And along those lines, we have been discussing, as the Minister says, with Children First, how best to go about producing a child-friendly version of the code, and also looking at whether we need to produce a code which is an easy-read version, for example, for those with learning difficulties or who may otherwise struggle to understand the code. And we'll be taking that forward over the next few months.
Slightly in terms of a child-friendly code as to what age group of child you would actually pitch it at. So otherwise it could potentially get quite complex.
that is one of the issues which we'd like to discuss with children first, because clearly a 7-year-old versus a 17-year-old, there's clearly a difference in understanding there.
Will there be pictures? And seriously, you know, for young children to understand.
I think, child-friendly versions and easy-read versions quite often have pictures in them to help aid understanding, particularly when we're talking about different stages of the justice process and different things that they might have to go through. There quite often are pictures.
Why are you not speaking to the Commissioner for Children, who I thought has to put out stuff all the
time?
We
have been in contact with the Children's Commissioner. Okay.
If I may address this issue of intermediaries, convener, our focus today has been on the effective implementation of other vital improvements to special measures under the Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014, but we intend to give consideration to intermediaries in due course, including as part of ongoing work to look at provision of support to those with communication difficulties through the appropriate adult scheme. We're also the barn house model in Norway. That approach was recently discussed in the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service Evidence and Procedure Review, which examined possible ways of improving how evidence is taken, including from children and vulnerable adult witnesses. And I believe the system would involve early evidence being taken and that being the only time in which evidence is required to be taken in the Norwegian model. But following the publication of the review's report earlier this year, SCTS arranged a series of events to explore the implications of the report's propositions with relevant agencies and bodies. And the events which ran between May and August brought together the Scottish Government, other justice agencies, the legal professions, victims groups, academics and others with an interest in criminal justice. And feedback from the events will be used in the preparation of a supplementary report, which will be shortly be submitted to the Justice Board for its consideration. I hope that helps the member with what we're doing on that particular aspect.
John.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. Minister, the EU directive encourages the that victims are treated by respect by police, prosecutors and judges, and that these individuals are properly trained to deal with them. Are you content that these regulations would adequately cover judges, and what avenue of redress would a victim have if there were a view that they hadn't been properly treated by a judge?
Well, I believe that, you know, obviously, once the regulations come in, training will obviously be essential to all who interact with vulnerable witnesses, and clearly where we're dealing with, as we've just been discussing, some particularly sensitive groups such as children and those who have suffered crimes of serious violence, it's important to understand and implement the latest thinking in terms of how we manage sensitively the needs of those victims and witnesses. And I would hope that through the work of the Justice Board and bringing together the various agencies, including the Court and Tribunal Service, and clearly through them the judiciary, to ensure that all are trained in how to implement best practice and in relation to vulnerable witnesses. I'm not sure if I picked up the point correctly.
I don't know, Minister, if you're aware of a recent publicity regarding a court case where the comments attributed to the initial trial judge, which surfaced at the subsequent appeal, were quite shocking, really, and I wonder the extent to which judicial training is it compellable? I mean, because there is a view that judges are, if you'll excuse the pun, a law unto themselves when it comes to a lot of this.
Well, clearly, that is something I can assure the member I can take forward. I'm not aware of the specific case, but I would have a concern to ensure that that all those who are required to understand the latest regulations, if this is passed by Parliament, are up to speed with what is required by government and indeed by Parliament in passing legislation. So I maybe invite my colleague Neil Robertson to comment on anything he's aware of in terms of the discussion around the role of judges in this respect.
Yes, we have contacted the Judicial Office of Scotland to do provide training to judges around the needs of victims and what is required in a court setting. So that is carried out regularly. I also can point out to the criminal justice agencies also carrying out a lot of work as well. For example, the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service trained all their court officers in association with Victim Support Scotland in how to deal with victims on the front line, because obviously they're dealing with victims coming into court to give evidence every day.
Are you able to say what sanction, if any, would be available to a victim who was aggrieved at the treatment?
If in terms of the competent authorities, we've put in place in the regulations provision to have a complaints procedure in place, which we see being the competent authority's normal complaints procedure. Now, that's normally a two-step process within the competent authority, and if they're not happy with that, they can then go further to the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman on the case of the police to park, after which, because these are now legally enforceable rights, judicial review could fall into place. What we are trying to avoid is the sort of circumstance where somebody perhaps didn't get the expenses they thought they would get for turning up at court to give evidence and having to go straight into raising a small claim action against the Crown Office to get their money back. We thought having using the complaints procedure would allow them to do it on a more informal basis and would be more user-friendly to the victim.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm grateful. Okay.
Is there not a role for the Lord President if a judge perhaps said something untoward rather than, I take it you can't complain to the Ombudsman about a court session judge, what would happen?
Indeed, I mean, there's obviously code of conduct for behaviour of judges in the court system, and the Lord President has oversight of the activities of judges. But I'm happy to come back, Convener, if this would be of interest to Mr Finney about what provisions there are in that respect, and discuss that with the Lord President when next to meet him.
Margaret McDougall, please.
Thank you. Could I just ask if any consideration has been given to the impact that these regulations will have on support services, and what measures have been put in place to ensure that there are enough services to meet the demand and that there are no barriers to accessing these services?
Well, clearly, we are very conscious that there has been some debate around the support for victims, organisations that represent and support victims through this process, and I fully accept Margaret McDougall's point that clearly the system to work well, we have to have well-supported organisations out there to provide support to victims, and often it can be less intimidating way of getting advice and support than going through through more formal channels and through the justice partners themselves. So I think it's important to state that we have had productive discussions with organisations representing victims and their rights, and believe that the provisions here do provide the legal framework, as discussed in the opening statement, for transposition of the directive, but equally through other channels we can provide the appropriate support to those organisations, and we'll continue to do so as required. And perhaps Graeme Ackerman, I know, who's had some discussions, this could add to this.
Sure. I mean, the first point I would stress is that, as the Minister said in his opening statement, the majority of the requirements in the regulations are things that various competent authorities already do. And on that basis, we don't think the impact on victim support services will be significant. However, we do appreciate that victim support services do provide a lot of support to victims across Scotland, and we are engaged with them to make sure that they're aware of what we're doing and to make sure that support is in place.
And just one further thing, if I may, Convener, just to add in, which will hopefully give reassurance to the member. Obviously, we are aware that victims can self-refer to Victim Support Scotland, regardless of whether they've reported the crime or not, and that may be their preferred way of approaching the issue. And secondly, we have placed an obligation on criminal justice agencies, and for formal reference, that's Police, Crown Office, Scottish Court and Tribunal Service, and others, to refer victims to Victim Support Services upon request as well. So there will be signposting to Victim Support Services to ensure that people are aware of what they have, and as Graeme is saying, existing mechanisms exist to provide support to those organisations.
Will these organisations have the resources to deal with any additional services that are asked of them as a result of this legislation and regulation?
Well, it's obviously difficult to anticipate what level of additional activity there would be, but there would be continued dialogue with victims' organisations, support organisations, to ensure that they have the resources they need, if and where possible, to support them in doing their work, which is obviously vitally important. I appreciate that. But obviously it's difficult to anticipate exactly what impact there will be. Obviously it depends on the prevalence of crime and the impact on individuals.
Okay, thank you. My next question is around the submission from Scottish Women's Aid, where they have commented on the regulation with regards to the victim's right to receive information concerning release of an offender. And while they welcome the proposed changes which would enable a victim to obtain certain information, for example, the release of a prisoner, including any license conditions. But there is nothing to say that they would get information when a prisoner was released, or temporarily released. So would you consider including that?
Well, if I may, I think I've recognised the importance of the issue from the point of view of providing timely information to individuals, but by enabling victims to receive information about prisoners serving less than 18 months imprisonment, we are, we believe, leading the way in the UK for victim notification services. For example, in England and Wales, VNS applies to sentences over 12 months. However, for those prisoners serving less than 18 months, we consider that a proportionate lighter touch approach should be taken rather than extending the full VNS. And for this reason, the scheme relating to such prisoners will be more closely mirror the directive requirements, for example, not including information about the death or transfer of a prisoner. In relation to a question raised by Scottish Women's Aid, prisoners sentenced to less than 18 months are more likely to be released on home detention curfew than on temporary release, and indeed temporary release for prisoners of less than 18 months is infrequent, if not rare. In considering whether a prisoner is eligible for temporary release, the Scottish Prison Service carried out a wide-ranging risk assessment involving community partners and the police. And if there was an assessed risk to a victim, temporary release would not be permitted, and prisoners released on home detention curfew fall within the scope of the new VNS. So, we think we're trying to take an approach here which does reflect the complexity of the situation and also the needs to, not in notifying certain examples where the death of a prisoner or transfer of a prisoner takes place, that's something that's not necessarily something that victims would want to be contacted about.
I mean, I understand what you're saying, but if a prisoner was released temporarily and he's already been assessed as not being a risk, but if the victim was to actually meet that individual in the street or on a bus, while they're out on temporary release, it would be quite a shock to that individual. And I suppose that's what I'm addressing, this confrontation, so that's why it would be good if that was included.
Okay. Perhaps bring colleague Neil Robertson in just to further explain the position as it stands.
I mean, there are certain circumstances where the victim would be made aware. I spoke to colleagues in Police Scotland, and that when prisoners are released, whether on a temporary or permanent basis, the victim is not necessarily made aware, but each release is assessed on a case-by-case basis, and a victim will be updated and protective measures put in place if they think there is a continued risk to that person.
I do take Margaret McGregor's point, convener, that there would be, I can understand the point about the concern that somebody might bump into an individual that they were unaware had been released, and how potentially in certain circumstances that could be quite upsetting, if not worse, for that individual. But I suppose the issue that we're dealing with here is that the temporary release for prisoners of less than 18 months is infrequent, if not rare, and there are notification procedures for those over 18 months, which are more rigorous. So relatively less, the more serious offences, if you like, there would be more rigorous information provided to individuals reflecting the increased risk to them. And obviously, as I say, if there was an assessed risk to a victim, then temporary release would not be permitted under the model for those under 18 months as well.
Yeah, but my issue is it's not around the risk. Yeah. It's just if a victim was to meet, the temporarily released prisoner, how distressing that could be for that individual. And I don't see how difficult it would be to actually carry out that and just include it in this regulation, so that they're told, if they're told when they're being released permanently, why can't they be told if they're on temporary release?
Mm-hmm. convener, my colleague.
Okay, it's a university challenge.
If I could, if, yes, indeed. If I could bring in Craig on this, that obviously I do take the point that, that Margaret McDougall is making. It's a very important one. And if I was a victim of crime, I would feel very uncomfortable if I bumped into an individual without knowing they'd been released. But if I could invite Craig to address this issue.
Short-term prisoners who are sentenced to 18 months or less will be released unconditionally at the halfway stage of their sentence, so that would be 9 months. And many of these prisoners achieve a home detention curfew, and that is their first form of release. And if they are granted home detention curfew, that is notified to the victim if they choose to receive that information. In terms of Section 27A, temporary release is a strange beast in that it's granted on a daily basis. And under the Section 16 of the 2003 Act, the main victim notification scheme, victims are only informed of the first point when the person becomes eligible for temporary release, rather than informing the victim every time that the offender is released. A offender could be released on day release for work on a daily basis and to, say, stack shelves in a supermarket and return to prison. So informing the victim every day that the person's released would create quite an administrative burden.
Wouldn't have to inform them every day. You could just say that this person is now being temporarily released on a daily basis, or, you know, whatever. You don't have to tell them once that they're now in that position.
Given that temporary release is relatively rare for offenders sentenced to this level of sentence, and the administrative burden that this places on the prison service, I think the decision was taken that...
If it's very rare, surely it wouldn't be an additional burden.
I think it still involves the checking of records to make sure that the people who are released and matching up that with the requests, because this is a system that works on the request.
I think it would be good to make further inquiry into that. I think the member makes a reasonable point. Rather than every single time they're released to work, but to let somebody know they're on some kind of thing. You might wander in the supermarket where they're stacking shelves. It's about managing people and victims as well, so that they understand they're not out the loop. So I think the member raises a fair point. But we'd like to hear further about this, perhaps, in writing, to explain what this would cope. If it's a scheme of a day release to do it every so often, tell the victim about it and then they'll know. They don't need to be told every single time. But I think they're raising a reasonable point. And the idea of risk, it's disturbing. It'd be very disturbing and upsetting to bump into them when you're doing your shopping in Tesco's and just supports this, you know, around the corner. This is the person that was put in jail, so there are issues.
Convener, I take the point entirely. I'm sure colleagues do as well in relation to this. I think just to repeat the point, we do see this issue as being relatively rare for under 18 months, but I do take the point that does mean that potentially the resource implications might not be in aggregate enormous. We will take that point away and discuss that further with Women's Aid, Scottish Women's Aid and others, and see if there's a way in which we can deal with that through the procedures that apply around the regulations, convener, and I'll try and address that for you.
Elaine, followed by Christian.
This is one you'll be aware of, the organisation, the Scottish Campaign Against Irresponsible Drivers. They argue in their submission to us that the regulations don't meet the underlying principles of the directive with regard to victims of traffic incidents, because they're saying that victims and injured and families bereaved by road crashes don't know when the penalty of disqualification imposed on offenders by the courts will not be fulfilled, and so there's not actually a sort of an opt-in process for them to find out whether or not, for example, somebody has applied to get their licence back early. Just wondered whether this was something which could be addressed in the code.
Well, I certainly think it's an interesting point that Dr. Murray raises. Firstly, I should note that SCID's proposal is not a directive requirement, so is not directly relevant to regulations in front of the committee today. However, we are aware of the proposal and gave it full and careful consideration earlier this year, together with Police Scotland, Court Service and Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service, and we have indicated to SCID that we do not intend to pursue the establishment of a notification scheme relating to the reinstatement of driving licences at present. but that we will keep this matter under review and consider again if any future work is carried out in relation to the information provided to victims and their families more generally. We have also initiated discussions with relevant justice organisations to explore what can be done to improve information available in the circumstances set out in SCID's proposal. For example, ensuring that bereaved families are aware that offenders may have their licence returned and on what timescales, so at the outset, so they know what to expect, and thus reducing the potential distress when families do observe offenders driving again. And we're also looking at this in the context of ongoing work to consolidate useful advice and assistance for victims and witnesses in our new website at www.mygov.scot. So hopefully that helps reassure the member that we are aware of the issue and that we are looking at what we can do to perhaps look at an alternative approach which might provide more information to families in advance if they have suffered a bereavement as a result of a road traffic accident or indeed a serious injury, and that they are suddenly become aware that an individual, on a similar basis to the point Margaret McDougall has made, that somebody suddenly sees them driving and they're not expecting that could be quite shocking. So,
Is SCID aware of these discussions? Have they been involved? Has SCID, the campaign, been involved?
I believe they have. Not with myself, Dr. Murray, but certainly with officials, I believe.
The other thing I wanted to ask about, obviously, at various times has been mooted that there should be a victims commissioner in Scotland to champion the rights of victims. I just wondered what your views on that was.
Yes, I mean, I'm aware that a victims commissioner has been proposed in the past and discussed more recently in the context of Victims and Witnesses Bill. I think the points raised by stakeholders groups such as Victim Support Scotland in their published report on Victims and Witnesses Bill and Scottish Women's Aid in their evidence to the committee on the 16th of April 2013 are the most compelling way to respond to this question. Money that might be spent setting up a new commissioner's office could instead be used on frontline service delivery. And we believe that a victims commissioner would largely duplicate the role being filled by Victim Support Scotland and other victim support organisations, and we feel the resources would be better used supporting the immediate needs of victims. I would be happy to consider revisiting this issue if the evidence and key stakeholders working on the ground agree that such a role would add value, though.
The Faculty of Advocates in their submission to us say that there doesn't appear to be a recognised mode of redress and no independent body to which complaint could be made. So if a victims commissioner is not the answer, is there some way in which the existing organisations could be strengthened in order to achieve that?
Sorry. I think we believe we've addressed that in the point we made earlier on to Mr. Finney, convener, in relation to complaints procedure in relation to the judiciary and other parties.
Except that the faculty says there does not, there are no independent body to which the complaint may be made. They go further than my colleague says, which is to review, deal with complaints, review the code, enforce the regulations. So it's more than it's actually reviewing the code and so on.
I mean, ultimately, I'm informed that this SPSO, the Ombudsman, would be able to review the quality of services that are provided. But to be happy to come back with further detail on that to your convener, if that would be helpful.
I've got, is Christian, what is yours on the same thing, or is it something else? Gil?
No, I was going to raise that question myself, convener, so I'm grateful for you letting me in. I wonder, Minister, if you would be prepared to monitor the effectiveness of the Commissioner's work in England, and see what fruit that bears. If you know, I understand what you're saying. It's always better using the money, you know, the best way we can. But here's something that's happening there, and we might get some evidence that would be, it may be cost effective.
That's a very reasonable point, I think, that Gil Paterson makes, convener. I mean, clearly, I said in my remarks there that we are open to persuasion if stakeholders believe it adds value. And clearly, if we can look at the operation of a similar system in England and see operationally that it is delivering for victims without taking resources, excessive resources away from the front line, then that's something clearly we can reflect on in the passage of time and come back with a proposal. But I suppose our first focus is to ensure that key organisations like Victim Support Scotland have the resources as best we can provide to meet the front line and immediate needs of victims and ensure that they are
given appropriate advice and support through what can be a traumatic process for them, hopefully one that is improving over time and becoming more sensitive to their needs. But clearly, as colleagues around the table have indicated, the importance of victim support services can't be overstated, and therefore, you know, we want to make sure they maximise the funding for them at the front line from resources we have.
Okay, thanks for that.
Christian, please.
There you go. Good morning, Minister.
Morning.
A couple of points, if I may, which were raised by Scottish Women's Aid and others. The first one will be on the regulation 2. We see some, we heard of some missing wording, particularly around the effect that the exercise of the rights under the Act and the provision of support is not conditional on a victim's residence status, citizenship or nationality. And maybe you can let us know why it's not in the regulation.
Well, the Regulation 2 regulations or the Act do not restrict in any way or impose conditions on the rights conferred to a certain class of citizen based on the resident status, citizenship or nationality. Accordingly, all victims of crime in Scotland, whoever they are or wherever they are, they may be from, benefit from the rights and protections under the directive. And I can also add that all victims' organisations funded by the Scottish Government place no such restrictions on the use of their services. So I hope that provides a reassurance to the member that the intent of the policy and indeed we believe the regulations as drafted will deliver for groups regardless of where an individual's from or their national status, that if they are a victim in Scotland, they receive support in Scotland.
Residual 10 of the directive was a lot clear on it and was warning it a lot clear on it. I might want to suggest that it would have maybe a good idea to repeat the same wording. The second point will be on regulation 3. I know that there's a lot which is very good, giving victims the ability to understand proceedings, but it's not so much or giving the right to be understood, and particularly it doesn't again follow the wording on the directive regarding enabling a victim to make a complaint in the language we understand. And if so, it would be minded maybe to amend the regulation appropriately, Minister?
Okay. Do you want to come in the amendment? I think I'll maybe bring Neil Robertson on the wording of the amendment.
Any victim using the complaints process would be covered by the further sections in the regulations, which is 3E, the right to understand, and 3F, the right to interpretation and translation. This coupled with the further general principle that victims should be able to understand information they are given and understood any information they provide will ensure that when making a complaint, they will receive the appropriate linguistic support. There's no need to make specific provision for it in the complaints process. It's covered elsewhere in the regulations. If they're obliged to receive information, they can have it translated for them.
I'm just thinking we spend a lot of time trying to translate what people are saying, what victims are saying, as opposed to maybe hearing their own words and maybe making sure that, you know, the justice system understand a lot better the language of their own victims, as opposed to the contrary.
Maybe just adding a point which I think is important in this, because clearly the ability for the victim to understand their rights is critical in this. So they're not likely to be sitting down with a copy of the regulations. The victim's code will be critical here and will be given out to victims of crimes. We are proposing that the victim's code will be translated in the top 10 languages and then on an on-demand basis as required for other languages to ensure that as far as we possibly can, we will make the appropriate information about persons' rights and their ability to seek translation services and other facilities that they need is very clear for them to understand and know what their rights are as a victim in Scotland.
I do understand this point, Minister. What I'm trying to say, it was not talking about foreign language, more talking about the way victims could express themselves in their own language, not talking about foreign language, but in their own wording, and making sure that, you know, people are trained to understand them as opposed to translating what they are saying in legal languages.
Yes, and I take that point. I don't know. Craig would like to come in, I think, convener on that point.
I think Section 3E in Regulation 5 goes some way to address that issue, in that the competent authorities must take measures to understand the information that that are given to the person by the authority, and also that they have to take measure to understand that the person's interaction with the authority. So it's a two-way process. They have to understand, take measures to understand the victim, and take measures to help the victim understand them.
It will be very helpful that it goes both ways, that the people, you know, when we talk to victims, we make sure we use their own language as much as possible.
I think there's a point in the regulation that might just be worth reading out verbatim, just so that it's clear as I read it. Under subsection 4B of 3E, there's take into account any personal characteristics of the person which may affect the person's ability to understand the communication and be understood in responding to the communication. So I think, you know, we do recognise that people go about their communication in different ways, and one, obviously, the concerns I think we all have if we're aware of those who end up in institutions like Parliament and Young Offenders Institute and other areas. There's clearly have been concerns about communication problems that some of the young offenders have there, and so therefore we need to understand people and understand how they communicate so they don't get frustrated. Equally similar as applies to victims, and so, you know, we need to understand, you know, how people are expressing themselves, because it will be a very emotional situation as well, and to be able to reflect on that.
You're welcome.
It was a specific concern from both the Faculty of Advocates and Scottish Women AIDS relating to Regulation 13 and 9A, victims' right to protection during criminal investigation, where the Faculty says we consider the meaning of criminal investigation in the directive using a purposeful interpretation to be wider than that set out in the Regulation 9A, or put another way, by Scottish Women AIDS. The article does not limit such protection to interviews carried out solely by the police. Both cite various things that should perhaps come under this interview: identification parades, searches, seizure of property, locus of visits, the victim being accompanied by a person when the Crown in solemn cases and sexual offendings, have meetings between the Crown, and so on and so forth.
Well, then, just in regards to the sort of perceived narrow definition of criminal investigation, the focus of Article 20 is protection during criminal investigations and in particular interviews, and this is backed up by the Commission's guidance, which makes it clear that the right to be accompanied relates solely to interviews with the police. Accordingly, we have legislated for the right of victims to support during police interview. The article calls for support during criminal investigations, and in Scotland there is already a well-established approach in drawing a line between criminal investigations and proceedings, namely that criminal proceedings begin when the report is lodged by the police with the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and it follows that precognition as part of criminal proceedings would not be covered by the directive. That's our understanding of what is required, and hence reflected in the regulations as they stand in regards to the treatment of Article 20.
I think they were looking, particularly Scottish Women say that the victim, because they're accompanied by a person of their choice, and that all and any meetings with competent authorities, unless there's a very good reason based on a possibly contrary interest or prejudice to the proceedings, then the section should be amended to reflect that position.
Can I bring Neil Robertson and that convener now?
In terms of directive compliance, as the Minister has stated, this only covers criminal investigations as far as interviews go. We have spoken to the competent authorities to ask them what would happen beyond that. And, for example, the police would consider allowing somebody to be accompanied at an identification parade if they thought that was appropriate. Crown Office, again, if they felt if it was appropriate, would allow a victim to be accompanied at the precognition stage. What the directive doesn't oblige us to do, so we can't do it without going beyond our powers to do so, is to provide a right to that. So it's not a case of saying, as soon as the first interview is over, the support drops away. That's not the case. It does follow through, but it's on a more bespoke basis that the individual needs of each victim are considered, and if they need support and they want that support with them, they would be allowed that.
I think as long as there's a discretion attached to it, there's always going to be some doubt, and that's possibly not the best way forward. Maybe something to note.
I've got, sorry, I'll just ask this question because I children first in the submission. Oh, I beg your pardon, Alison, do you want to ask that one? Children first in the submission are concerned about the definition of parent. I quote, although we understand that the definition of parent in the regulations refers to any person holding parental responsibilities for that child within the meaning of the Children Scotland Act 1995, it'd be helpful to clarify the rights of informal kinship carers who do not have or do not yet have parental responsibilities in this context. That embraces quite a lot of people, and I wonder if you could advise about that. What rights would these informal carers have, as it were?
Well,
many of them grandparents.
As I understand, Convener, there is a power for competent authorities to extend the victim's rights to other appropriate persons, including kinship carers, if it's in the child's best interest to do that. That hopefully will help broaden the point. But I appreciate that you may be striking a slightly different point from
the point I mean is they don't have a statutory position. You know, they're not, they are kinship carers, but they don't yet have in statute parental responsibilities. They may have applied for them and may not yet. I mean, some of them may in fact have ended up with these responsibilities within days of anything happening. It may involve parents who are in fact part of a prosecution and they've taken the children. So it's really to know if something quickly can be done to give these kinship carers, informal ones, some kind of rights that they would have.
Well, if we can bring
it'd
me Robertson
sort of quickly
on
done.
Section 29A, I think. Yeah. Convener.
29A allows the parents, obviously, to come in if that's appropriate to do so. However, if there are circumstances you rightly identify where it may not be appropriate for a parent to be there to support a child, and for that purpose, 29A4 allows the function to be exercisable in relation to at the request of such person as the authority considers appropriate, having regard to the age, maturity, views, needs and concerns of the child. So there is a provision whereby if a parent is not the suitable person, somebody else can be brought in to support that child.
So the parent had, the child was a victim, let's say, of what parent had done.
Yeah.
Could someone be almost immediately in place? I mean, how quickly can that be done?
They would go through the steps. Go, first of all, is it in the interest of the child to have the child there themselves? For example, we're looking at examples where somebody's 16 or 17, they could be living away from home, they could have their own employment. Is it appropriate in that circumstance to involve the parents? Maybe for a younger child it would be, maybe at that age they make a decision. Then you go on to the parents and say, is it appropriate that the parents are involved?
I'm talking about a case where it's the parents.
Yes. Is it
unfortunately, it happens.
In the best interest of the child for the parents to be involved?
Well,
and
no,
if the answer to that is immediately no, you then go on to the subsection 4, which is another appropriate person, which would cover kinship carers or indeed a range of people.
Informal, when they're not statutory kinship carers. I'm talking about an informal where somebody just suddenly has the children. They had to take the children in as an emergency. Things are going at a rate of knots. You know, how quickly can it be that these individuals, often grandparents or sisters or something, that they could be in that role? That's really the case I'm looking for. So there's not a loophole, there's not a gap.
No, I mean, there's obviously things that may have to take into account, such as background checks and the like, to make sure that person's appropriate.
Yes.
But it is as the authority considers appropriate, so the authority will take into account.
The authority being?
The competent authority. It's most likely to be the police when the child's maybe there for interview.
I just think that was covered. So, Alison.
Oh, thank you.
Sorry, I didn't know you were reading.
No, it's okay. Sorry if I had indicated some time ago. I just want to return briefly to resourcing, Minister. The regulations place duties on the police and the court services in relation to the individual assessment of victims in criminal investigations and, of course, the protection of victims, and includes things like specially designed interview rooms, specialist interviewers and separate waiting rooms for victims in court buildings. What assurances can you give us that the competent authorities will prioritise capital spend on some of these issues?
Happy to come back to the committee with some detail on this, but I'm aware from responding to previous parliamentary questions, others and briefings that I've had in front of me, that significant work has been done to improve the experience of victims in the court estate, for example. Just one practical example, that's something that's been a high priority for colleagues in the Justice Board to try and address, obviously, with the increased number of cases that are coming forward to sheriff courts, which are dealing with domestic violence and sexual abuse cases. This is becoming more and more important as a proportion of the court's work, and so clearly an ever bigger focus on making sure the experience is one that is minimises the trauma for the victim coming to the court. If it would be helpful to the member, we can perhaps come back with some practical examples of what has been done to date, but clearly going forward it will be an area that we treat as a high priority, especially given the focus from the First Minister downwards on tackling domestic violence and sexual abuse in Scotland.
Thank you, Rod, because I know the Minister, you have another commitment to another committee, and we've got another item. Yes.
Just very short. Minister, obviously these regulations are intended to transpose the directive. It's clear to me that obviously based on our 2014 legislation and these regulations, that kind of victims is kind of a moving feast. Kind of, what assurances can you give us that the government will kind of monitor closely how victims are being treated in the system and review what further, if any, steps are needed?
Well, I can certainly give a personal commitment. That's something that I take very seriously, as I know the Cabinet Secretary does, and indeed, for reasons I've just given to Alison McInnes, it's something that's a very high priority for government and indeed, I think, opposition parties to see, you know, that the experience for, particularly for women and men, of course, occasionally suffering domestic violence and sexual abuse, is the experience has improved. And I think all of us clearly are concerned about the welfare of children going through the vulnerable witnesses going through the court system. So it will be and remain a high priority for the government. And indeed, I think the direction from the European Commission as well is going to maintain a focus on this as we go through. It's been taken forward as one of the priorities for the Dutch presidency as they take on the presidency. I've just assumed that for next year. So over the next 6 months, I think there'll be an even bigger focus on what member states and within them jurisdictions within member states are doing to tackle this issue. So I think there's a growing momentum both at European and domestic level to tackle this issue.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That ends the evidence session. Can I say to members, we had a very full session on this, and we could write a report on this. I think it would be quite useful so that we can review the position. If, in fact, if this next item 4 goes through, we can ask monitors. We've raised lots of rather interesting issues. You'd be content to do a short report. I haven't got time. And moving on to item 4. Now move to formal debate on the motion to approve the instrument. I invite the Minister to move motion S4M14801. The Justice Committee recommends that the Draft Victims' Rights Scotland Regulations 2015 be approved. Does any member wish to speak in the debate on the motion? The question is... Did you move it, Minister?
You were so fast, Convener, I didn't quite get in there.
But formally moved. I noticed you hadn't moved. The question is that motion S4M14801 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. I'm now going to move on to item 5. I'm sorry, Minister, without any suspension, straight on so that you can keep your schedule. It's considered as my second affirmative instrument, the Draft Justice of the Peace Court Special Measures Scotland Order 2015, and the officials are staying. I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement. It's up to you, but you're the man that knows your timetable.
Thank you, Convener. I will keep it very brief. The Justice of the Peace Special Measures Scotland Order 2015 is the second instrument, of course, today before the committee, which contributes to our transposition of Directive 2012-29 EU, the Victims' Rights Directive. I've already set out the background to our transposition approach, but it may be useful to outline briefly the purpose of this specific SSI. This order allows special measures to be used for the benefit of vulnerable witnesses giving evidence in the Justice of the Peace Courts. Special measures include, for example, enabling vulnerable witnesses to give evidence from behind a screen to prevent them seeing the accused, or via live TV links so they do not have to be present in court. These special measures have been available for some time in the Sheriff and High Courts, and indeed were recently expanded through the Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014. We consider that this extension is required to ensure compliance with the Victims' Rights Directive, but also that in principle it is right that the same protection should be available to vulnerable witnesses giving evidence in the JP Courts. And I look forward to taking the committee's questions.
Thank you very much. Any questions from members? Roddy.
Minister, are you able to clarify for the record why when special measures were first introduced, these courts weren't included? Is that?
In terms of the process, they are clearly we're bringing them up to date with the remainder of the estate. While it's not for me to speak for a previous administration, I understand that during the passage of the Vulnerable Witnesses Bill in 2003-04, the then Scottish Executive set out two reasons why it considered that extending special measures to the district courts was not considered necessary. And this was firstly due to the need for extension not having been demonstrated, and secondly, the future of district courts being unclear pending the outcome of the review of a summary justice being carried out by Chair Principal McInnes at that time. With the uncertainty of the district courts now resolved, unification of the JP courts having been completed in 2010, with the implementation of the 2014 Act progressing and compliance with the directive we've discussed today on victims' rights, the EU directive at the fore, this government considered now was the time to commence the provisions in the 1995 Act and make special measures available in the JP courts as well.
Thank you.
No other questions. Right. I now move to the formal debate on the motion to approve this and invite the Minister to move motion S4M14802. The Justice Committee recommends the draft Justice of the Peace Court Special Measures Scotland Order 2015 be approved.
Formally moved.
Does any member wish to speak in the debate? Take it, they don't. The question is that motion S4M14802 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? As members are aware, required to vote on all affirmative instruments. I've already mentioned the previous one where we might do a more lengthy report. And are you content to delegate authority to sign off these on the two instruments we consider today? Thank you very much. Can I thank the Minister? And thank you for the session. And I'll suspend for 5 minutes before we move on to item 7. Thank you very much. I move on to item 7 of the agenda, Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. And this is an evidence session. And I welcome to meeting the Right Honourable Lord Carloway, Lord Justice Clark, Edward McHugh, Deputy Legal Secretary to the Lord President, and Sheriff Gordon Liddell, Vice President of the Sheriff's Association. Okay, thank you very much, Lord Carloway, for your statement, which will, of course, go on the Justice website. And while I know Sheriff's Association didn't respond to ours, they did respond to the government's consultation. So I take it they've not changed their position since then.
No, there's no change.
Excellent. That makes it simple for us. Can I now then go straight to questions from members, please? Margaret, Christian, Gill, John.
Good morning. The bill for the first time in Scotland introduces two statutory jury directions which must be given by the judge in when certain evidence is led. I wonder if you consider that statutory jury directions represent an unacceptable precedent with regard to the independence of the judiciary.
Lord Carloway.
I wouldn't quite go that far. The statutory jury directions have been introduced, as you know, in other jurisdictions of the Commonwealth. And I think what I'm trying to say is that this could be done, but it is not what we would see as the best way of doing it. In other words, we've suggested that if what is wanted is for these facts to be accepted by the courts, then the better way to do that is to declare that these facts are within judicial knowledge, which would enable a judge in any given case to give these directions without the necessity of there being any evidence. But it would then leave it to the judge to decide in exactly what case these directions ought to be given. The position being that jury directions are intended to be real conversations in that sense between the judge and the jury, and this is introducing a degree of not exactly artificiality, but it's quite a mechanistic way of doing things. And a requirement to tell the jury these facts without more is going to be problematic.
Thank you, that's very helpful.
Can I just add, but you're a bit tougher in your statement about that, Lord Carloway. You say what is proposed is that the judge should essentially take on the mantle of the prosecution in making statements of fact dressed up as law.
Yeah,
that's a bit tougher, isn't it?
Yes, I think that's fair to say. What the Act would do is that they would require the judge to state facts as law. In other words, the law says that these are facts, and these are facts which are designed to be in favour of the complainer in the case. Now, that traditionally has been the mantle of the prosecutor to argue these matters before the jury, for the defence to make such submissions as they wish to do in response, and for the judge to act as the arbiter between them.
Sheriff Little, do you want to comment?
Yes, I'd perhaps add to that. We take the view, and I don't think there's any difference between us in the Sheriff's Association, that is, that there are dangers involved in legislating for something that has to go in a jury speech. What occurs in just about every jury speech is a repetition to the jury of the fact that they are the masters of the facts, and that anything that's said by the judge in charging the jury needn't be taken into account by them, and anything that's said by the prosecutor in the speech or said by the defence in the speech needn't be taken into account by them, and they're only there to indicate that that evidence exists and it should be taken into account, you know, that the jury may take it into account depending on what they make of it. There is a place for what's being suggested in some trials, but no two trials are the same, and depending on the evidence that's come out in a trial, suggestions could well find their place in a number of them. But there may equally be circumstances where, if this is mandatory and this has to be included in a jury speech, then what will be required is something to dilute it in order to fairly charge a jury and not encroach on the jury function, because the function of the judge is entirely different with a jury. I could see it almost having the adverse effect to what appears to be the desired effect, where if it was necessary that such words have to be used in every case, and you've a set of circumstances where you really have to tell the jury, however, it may well be that that's not the case. That one thing, you could confuse a jury because they would wonder, why are we being told one thing and then told another thing? Apart from that, there's almost a risk run with juries that, although we feel anyway, that although you stress to a jury that something that's said by me as a judge needn't be taken into account, they're looking for indicators from judges, and we have to go out of our way to avoid a jury being influenced in any way whatsoever by what we might say. And so to come back, what I'm really saying is that there are life situations. No two jury charges are ever the same. We have the jury manual, which is a dynamic volume of suggestions and recommendations. And I think that the place for such suggestions is in the jury manual, so that judges dealing with a certain array of facts and evidence that's come out can look at that and decide whether such a thing should be included in the charge or not. I would also suggest that on the back of that, we have the High Court, and if a judge at first instance, which is what it is with a jury, makes an error, then it's correctable.
What about the role of expert witnesses in giving the same, I suppose, information?
Yes, the current position is that that there is specific provision in the 1995 Act, as is mentioned, I think, in the statement, for the Crown to lead evidence, basically to the same effect as is stated in the bill. The Crown can do that, but to do that in every case would be very expensive. On the other hand, in many cases, that evidence is basically agreed, because ultimately it's not controversial, so that the Crown will have an expert report, and they can go to the defence and say, well, will you agree that, for example, there can be good reasons why a person has not reported an incident for a year, 2 years, 20 years. And the joint minute which will agree the evidence is usually much more expansive than what is contained in the bill, and will contain greater explanations for what is contained in the bill. But following on from what Sheriff Liddell is saying, one can envisage the situation where if a judge gives the jury the direction which is stated in the bill, as Sheriff Liddell is saying, one can just imagine the judge immediately going on to say, however, in this case, you will have to consider whether the delay in reporting is significant or not, or the same thing would apply in the later proposed directions. And there's a danger of achieving exactly the opposite of what the bill is intended by ultimately focusing on something which is not an issue. In other words, if nobody has said in the jury speech that the delay in reporting is significant, why focus on it?
Only just one small point about the minute of agreement. It won't be the first time a very skilled defence lawyer has brushed over the minute of agreement and then made a lot of some other points which then have put doubts in the jury's mind. So I'm always very sceptical about just the use of the minute of agreement.
No, I agree with that. Even if these facts were agreed, that the fact that there can be good reasons why a person would not report does not preclude the defence from saying that in a given case it should be regarded by the jury as significant. And the question is whether it's perceived that a judge stating these
will actually achieve the object of the bill, which is intended, I think, to reverse perceived misconceptions in the minds of the jury. That would be odd for that to happen when set against what Sheriff Little has said is our standard introduction, which is, we are the masters of the law, you must pay attention to what we're saying about the law. You are the masters of the fact. It's a matter entirely for you, the jury, to decide what to make of the evidence.
Gil, the trouble is everybody's going to be asking about jury direction, so there really are no supplementaries in this, I suspect. You're just next after Christian, but I think we really will be focusing on jury directions. Christian, and then it's you, Gil.
Yes, and it's in direction. Good morning. I just wanted to ask the panel if they were aware of some of the evidence that Professor Vanessa Munro has given us using mock juries. And we heard from Lord Calloway this morning already saying that other jurisdictions are already using this kind of procedure. So just wanted to know if you knew about the evidence out there.
We are aware of the research which was carried out by Professor Munro and her colleague, which is referred to in the consultation paper. I have not myself looked at the research behind that, but I'm aware of what it is suggesting, which is that there is a view that some members of the jury may have preconceived views about the matters in the bill. So that is accepted, which is why the Crown leading evidence to rebut such things may well be a good idea. And as I've said, I think, in the written statement, that the idea that these facts should be regarded as judicial knowledge may well be a good idea to enable the judge to give these directions in a suitable case.
Has any of the members of the panel have looked at the research?
I've read the research, in the as Lord Carlaway has said, it's in the document that was the SPICE briefing, but not the research behind it. I don't want to be critical of the research, but it's only a very small sample that was taken and three scenarios that were set up. It might well be the case, and I think probably could be imagined as the case, that each juror as a member of the public, an ordinary member of the public, brings with them, in most anodyne way, I mean this, certain prejudices. They bring with them their own feelings, their own views on things. And those views will be covering all manner of things and not just this single aspect of it. And short of abolishing juries, I don't see how you can actually address that.
We've heard about this evidence and how these misconceptions are very much present not only in juries but in society at large, and that this act would be a way to address those. And particularly when we talk about how to address them, if we talk about appropriate time, will be at the start of the procedure, and regarding cases, it will be for all cases attributed to this particular subject. And I'm a bit surprised when I read some of the submissions saying that it should be only at appropriate time and appropriate cases. It seems to miss the point that regarding with the evidence, that it should be for every cases and at the start of the procedures.
Well, the directions would be given at the end of the, they'd be given in the charge to the jury at the end of the case. And it's suggested in, I think, some of the documents accompanying the bill, that it would remain for the judge to decide exactly what was said. I'm not sure that's right, because if an Act of Parliament says the judge must advise that, and then states actually,
Lord Carloway, in Section 6, Subsection 3, there is an opt-out clause there which says, Subsection 2, which is mandatory, does not apply if the judge considers that in the circumstance of the case no reasonable jury could consider the evidence, question or statement by reason of which Subsection 2 would otherwise apply to material to the question where they're alleged. So there's still some judicial discretion.
There's a judicial discretion as to whether to give the directions, yes. But if you decide that it is a case which applies to the case, you must give this particular direction.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, I don't think the Act, in its present form, allows the judge to vary it in some way. That would seem to be contrary to what Parliament would state.
Okay.
And it remains the case that if you could imagine a charge to the jury actually taking place in a given case, the judge is going to say, I am required to advise you that there can be no good reason why a person, etc.
Yes.
And at the end of that, the judge is then free to give such other directions as he thinks is appropriate to achieve the appropriate balance of fairness in the case. And that's what would cause me concern, that what the Act is going to do is in certain cases, it's going to focus an issue for the jury, which is not really something in dispute.
Okay. I understand. Christian, no, sorry, but just
I'm,
to clarify
I'm not
that
saying, I don't think any of us are saying, I don't think any of us have any problem with this type of direction being given in appropriate cases. We think that there may also be force in the view that some judges might be reluctant to give these directions in the absence of evidence to support them, that is to say evidence in the case. But the way around that is to state that these are judicial knowledge, and then that enables the judge to state these as fact.
Did you say that just now? You know, that just because it's a general statement, or do they do a specific in a case? What do judges say at the end if someone has delayed reporting, didn't show signs of violence? What would a judge actually say just now, if anything, in directions to the jury or a sheriff, for that matter, or other?
Well, again, I'll answer that question. The answer is it's variable, as I think is recognised. But if you can imagine that there has been a delay in reporting now, there can be different types of delay. There can be a delay of a week, there can be a delay of a year, there can be a delay of 20 years. Imagine the dynamic of the trial. Somebody is going to ask the complainer why there was a delay in reporting, and the complainer will give a response to that, and the response will be, could be a number of things. Therefore, if there is an explanation from the complainer as to why there has been a delay in reporting, which can be to do with embarrassment, etc., all sorts of things, not wanting to go through the trial process and so on and so forth, then the judge will listen to what is said about that in the speech from the Crown and from the speech of the defence, and will then try to balance these two things up. But in the situation that we're envisaging here, just focusing on this section rather than the other two, many judges will say, of course, ladies and gentlemen, you will appreciate that just because someone has not reported an incident for a period of a week, a month, a year, whatever it is, it means that the incident did not happen. You have to listen to what the complainer said about that, why she didn't report. You have to appreciate there may be many reasons why somebody does not report it. On the other hand, you have the submission of defence counsel to the effect that this is significant, and that is something that you will have to bear in mind when assessing the credibility and reliability of the complainer. That would be relatively commonplace. On the other hand, some judges would not go into the issue, and they would just leave it for the jury to determine.
If I may, one of the things that I see, certainly I think all of us see in every charge to a jury, is that on the one hand, depending on what the jury's made of the evidence, they may draw certain inferences from the evidence, but they're given a specific warning against speculation. And this would, if such a thing arose in a trial that I was dealing with, I think probably all of my colleagues, that it was suggested that there could be speculation, this would be the area of speculation, then there might well be a warning given against that, and with a specific reference to a piece of evidence to illustrate to the jury that there they could be entering into the realm of speculation rather than drawing a reasonable inference from evidence which exists.
Thank you. That was very helpful. Gil.
Much, Convener. I wonder if the panel could tell me if one individual jury member that you were aware that they had preconceived ideas on a matter, how would you react to that?
If it came to light during the course of the trial that a jury had views which suggested that he or she considered that a person could not be guilty of rape if there was no use of violence, something like that.
Yeah, something. Well, maybe I should explain. Maybe if you were aware that someone before the trial started had preconceived ideas.
of a nature.
I'm not sure that we would ever know that
unless they put it on a Facebook or something. That'd be.
But so if we did,
if
we did know, somebody would object to that juror sitting on the jury.
Okay. Yeah. So the evidence from Professor Vanessa Monroe suggests that the public, never mind juries, the public themselves mm-hmm. have preconceived ideas how someone should react. In other words, if someone comes in that claims rape, shouldn't be calm. They shouldn't be calm. They should act in a particular way. Yes. Or they should automatically have resisted, so they should be injured in some fashion, and that doesn't always happen. So if this, and there's other evidence that suggests the same thing, mainly coming from women's groups, it's anecdotal evidence when you're engaged in that area. They talk about it all the time. However, if that is the case, if this evidence stacks up, should we not need to do something about it? If you would react to one jury member, but the evidence would suggest a good number of the general public have got preconceived ideas how people should perform and act in a case when it comes to it.
I don't think that, again, we're not in any way suggesting that in a given case, what is contained in the bill should not be said to juries in a given case. What we are saying is that what is proposed is not procedurally the best way to go about it, nor in practical terms is it the best way to go about it. There is an element of, to some extent, trusting the judges to act in an appropriate way in an appropriate case. And if the suggestion is made during the course of the trial by, for example, defence counsel of the nature that you're suggesting, I personally would expect the judge or sheriff to react to that comment and to correct it. That would be part of his or her job to do that. But to make it a mandatory direction in almost all cases it causes the problem, and I know I'm repeating myself here to some extent. Again, imagining the dynamic of the trial as it happens, and you giving the jury the direction required by Parliament, fine. Then the judge is going to go on. He or she will go on to say, you have to look at this case and the evidence in this case. We give juries direction specifically to deal with general prejudices in the case. We give jury directions that they must decide the case purely on the evidence which is laid before them. And one would expect, in the dynamic of the jury room, if someone has a prejudice of some description, then the other jurors would presumably attempt to address that in their deliberations. They may not, but I would expect that they would.
And how would you overcome, if the evidence is correct, that there's a percentage of the public, and they don't see it as a prejudice. They see the way people act and react and how they compose themselves in a case like this. And if they don't conform to that, they're automatically not believed. There's the evidence would suggest the members of the public and juries. So every trial that takes place, it would suggest there will be people there who have got preconceived ideas, and they don't mean to do it. It's not that they're bad people. It's just that they think that this woman, or even a man now, that we can talk about, this person must be lying because they're not acting the way that I expect them to act. This didn't happen. So if that is the case, if the evidence suggests that is the case, how do we overcome that? How do we, other than some education through the Scottish Government, but I would think that the court is the best place to do it. People are presenting there and listening to evidence, but if they are wrong at the start, do you think it should be explained, or is there a better reason why not to explain that?
You've raised a very interesting point about the way people think generally or in society, but we're trying to look at this from a very practical point of view. We're not in any way suggesting that efforts should not be made to correct misconceptions in juries. And in a given case, the judge will be expected to do that if it's detected. But we go back to what we've said already. We the judges, are direct the jury on the law which is to be applied to the case. That's our primary purpose. We say to juries at the beginning, the facts are for you. It's for you to assess the witnesses and to make up your minds, applying your collective common sense. That's the function of the jury. If a judge is seen to dictate or attempt to dictate to a jury on what facts should or should not be found, again, you're in the realms of what one is saying is being counterproductive. I don't think I can answer your question about how to deal with this problem, other than to say we've offered an alternative solution which we think would fit in with our system rather better than what is proposed here and would work from a more practical point of view. And if we go back to approaching these facts as judicial knowledge, then we can go back to our judicial institute and say, right, devise some model directions along the lines that they have done in England.
And now I've got John by Alison Jordan, please.
Thank you. Lord Calloway, if I note you correctly, you talked about, used the phrase appropriate manner, but of course it is the case that not all judges act in an appropriate manner, and I'm having particular regard to the Court of Appeals ruling in the last couple of weeks, where there was criticism made of the judge who was quoted as saying that the victim of multiple rapes had acquiesced in these rapes, and there was comment made about delayed reporting and the fact that the victim continued to cohabit with the accused. So I'm trying to understand the difference between comment and direction and when there's an overlap there. Are you able to give some guidance on that, please?
The case to which you're referring to, the important thing to bear in mind in that case is that there is no criticism whatsoever of the judge's directions to the jury in that case, nor indeed in his conduct of the trial. The convictions followed in what was rather quite an unusual trial an unusual trial. So there is no criticism of the judge there, and I'm not aware of any criticism of judges' directions to the jury on the particular points with which this bill is concerned.
The relationship between comments that a judge would make and direction, you say directions on the specifics of the law.
No, there's been no criticism of the judges.
No, in general, right? If we set that case aside, then in general, please.
I wonder if you could ask your...
What's your question, John, in the general question?
Judges will make comments, presumably, in the course of their direction, they'll make comments on what's been heard, and they will comment specifically in relation to their position on the legal issues that gives rise to.
In the course of directions to the jury,
yes,
a judge will be expected to direct the jury in accordance with our well-known principles and practice. And again, I go back to stating that I'm unaware of any criticism of a judge's directions to the effect which would contradict or in any way affect what is contained in the bill. I think what you're referring to are not directions to a jury, nor indeed any statements made during the course of the trial, but certain comments which were made by the judge at the point when he is reporting to the appeal court on the reasons for his sentencing. These reports are released to parties. They may be mentioned during the course of the appeal proceedings. It's very important that a judge should feel free to state exactly why he has selected a particular sentence, and to be given free rein to explain his reasoning. If during the course of that reasoning he says something which the appeal court determines is wrong, then we will say that, as we did in the particular case. We will expect the judge to take into account what the appeal court's view is, and act accordingly. In sexual offences generally, in relation to the matters which you've raised. As I think I've, I hope Mrs. McInnes has got my reply. You, as I'm sure the committee will appreciate, in relation to the prosecution of sexual offences and indeed the sentencing of sexual offences, the law is progressing and it's moving from a certain position where it was 20, 30, 40 years ago into the modern era. And we are trying to keep the law so far as both approaches to directions and in relation to sentencing in tune with modern thinking. You were referring, for example, to the, something called acquiescence or condonation, as it's sometimes said. The reason why that was being mentioned was in a particular case in the late 80s, which was the first case in which a husband had been prosecuted for the rape of his non-estranged wife, in which it so happens I was the advocate deputy at first instance. That went to the appeal court, and the appeal court there, the Lord Justice General in that case, made remarks of that nature, primarily in relation to whether a person should be prosecuted or would be prosecuted for the rape of his wife with whom he was continuing to live, where the wife had, as it was put, forgiven the act. So, you know, we're sitting on an appeal court decision of that nature, where these words have been used. They have also been used, or similar words have been used, in the sense of whether the fact that someone is continuing to live with someone is something that should be taken into account, not in relation to the rape, which would be proved, and there's a conviction, but whether that is a significant feature on sentencing. And the issue of the continued cohabitation with someone and the effect that it has on sentencing is something that I think most jurisdictions are wrestling with, and there are different views being expressed in the Commonwealth as to how significant that is, not in relation to whether the person was raped, not in relation to conviction, but simply in relation to the appropriate sentence in that type of case.
I'm grateful for that detailed explanation. There's not everyone that gets the Lord Justice Clerk's personal explanation like that. So public perception is very important, and it is out there some terms, and I won't repeat some of them, that people would find deeply offensive. Now, I have to say, I want to maintain an open mind on this, and that's why I'm trying to understand to what extent there is freedom afforded a judge to make comment in general terms, away from the specifics of direction and law.
Can we just clarify? I think John's point is, if we say jury directions are a specific thing at the end of the evidence that's led, at any point, if a judge makes a highly inappropriate remark, which might affect the impact or the jury decision, and yet it's not actually in the jury directions, what's the redress or what impact does that have on that decision? That's what you're separating, remarks made in the process of the trial separately from jury directions.
Well, not entirely, no.
You're not?
I think if we, the totality of summing up, presumably a judge can say things that might be determined as legal direction, and there will be comment allied to that.
Could I comment, if I may, on this? I'm sure that the members of the committee do understand how a jury trial unfolds, but it might be important just to lay that out. That, you know, the judge is sitting and listening to all of the evidence and takes notes of all of the evidence and will review that evidence when it comes to charging the jury. There's a prosecution speech, first of all, to the jury. And that the prosecutor will probably suggest what the jury should make of the evidence. There's then a defence speech where the defence will probably suggest to the jury what they make of the evidence. That's listened to by the judge. The judge hears all of that. And it's at the end of that, the judge, having heard that, will modify perhaps what that judge thought would go into the charge. And the charge is dynamic. The charge deals with everything, the evidence that's come into the case and what's been said in the speeches. And it's at that point the judge will be at pains to say that the judge is the master of the law and gives the jury what assistance they require in understanding the law that has to be applied, but that the facts are for them, and make certain, if necessary, draw attention to parts of the evidence only because the jury has to know what to do with that, how they take it into account, and where they place it if they make something of it. But it's a very dynamic situation, and every case turns on its own circumstances. If you have something which is mandatory, then the biggest danger in that is the unintended consequences, where because that takes prominence to such an extent that as a judge I may be required by law to interfere to an extent with the jury function, which I would never do. You know, it's hardwired into judges that they don't interfere with the jury function, which is a consideration of the evidence.
Can I ask then, finally, and I mean this as respectfully as I want to, I mean, do you resent lawmakers suggesting an approach like this? Because, as we've heard from Mr. Patterson, there's real genuine public concern about these matters. As I say, I'm probably pro-minded more for the prosecution leading an expert witness, but is there a resentment on the part of the judiciary that politicians are interfering?
I wouldn't describe it as a resentment. No, we're all members of democracy. We respect Parliament's function as legislators. If Parliament wishes the judges,
however coming though.
Well, there may be a however, but in a sense, but we don't get upset in that way. If Parliament wants to tell us to give the jury these directions, we'll give them.
Good.
We'll certainly do that. But we have, I think, stated that traditionally it's the role of the judge to give a jury's directions rather than Parliament. And that's the way it has been insofar as the division of constitutional responsibilities is. But that only takes you so far. In any jurisdiction in the Commonwealth, it's rare, very rare, for Parliament to dictate to the judges what they should say in jury directions. It's been done in a couple of jurisdictions in this particular area. So if you want us to do it here, then we'll do it here. But we're just saying this is not necessarily the best way to do it.
Yeah, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. We appreciate that if we make that law, you won't break it. I understand that. That's handy. Yeah. A bit of difficulty for you. Alison, followed by Roderick, please.
Thank you. If I might just have a follow-up to what Mr. Finney has said and then go on to my main question. I suppose I'm concerned that if a judge, in giving his reasons for sentencing to an appeal court, has views that are so significantly out of step that it results in you describing them as pithy, then surely we can expect that those strong views would be present all the time in that judge's consideration and would influence whether or not he gave a direction to the jury about any particular thing. Is that not the case?
Again, I'm anxious not to stray into a particular case, because we said all that we really wanted to say about it in the opinion of the appeal court. And as I think I've written, the word pithy wasn't intended to be pejorative. It was just saying these were succinct remarks which the judge made on certain areas of sentencing. But the particular directions in that case, so far as we are aware, were impeccable. And there's no sense of the judge's remarks which he sent to the appeal court being contained.
It is the absence of direction, perhaps, in relation to something. You've said that in other cases, a number, and I don't want to talk about that particular case, but just draw from that you've said that some judges give directions in some areas in relation to some of the things that Mr. Patterson spoke about, and some don't. What we're trying to get to the bottom of is why don't they? And is it basically the belief system that they themselves hold?
No. The reason why there is a problem in this area is that some judges take a very strict view of what they can tell the jury. In other words, some judges say, well, it is, if we take this proposition, there can be good reasons why a person may not tell others about it for a while. Some judges will take a strict view, well, in this case, there is no evidence to support that proposition. Therefore, I should not give a jury a direction of that nature. Of course, the Crown may lead evidence that it is the case, in which case they will give the direction. Other judges may be rather more proactive in their approach of what they say to juries, and they may give the directions contained here without there being an evidential base for it. If they do so, then of course they risk the appeal court stating to them, you should not have given that direction because in this particular case there was no evidence to support it. That's the problem area, which is why I think this legislation is in contemplation, and there is that difference in view between different members of the judiciary.
That's helpful. Can I turn to the jury manual, which Sheriff Liddell described as a dynamic document? Can you explain to us how that document is changed over time, how and when it's amended, and I suppose why model directions for this situation have not yet been developed?
Yes, I can certainly to help you with these. The jury manual is a fairly substantial document, which is, it's online if you wish to view it in its entirety, and but you can see what it looks like in the sense that it's something which we've created over the last 20 or so years, where from a situation where there was nothing essentially except kind of word of mouth, and it contains two different things. It contains, first of all, perceived statements of what the law is thought to be, and it contains model directions to the jury, which judges do not have to follow and will not follow depending on the particular circumstances of the case. And a lot of judges will have their own styles of speaking, etc., which is not consistent with the jury manual. The jury manual is under the auspices of a committee headed by one of the High Court judges, who will revise its terms I'm not sure if it's exactly an annual basis, but it's in a position of constant revision. And if a judge, for example, has a particular problem with the direction, or some new case arises, or of course if Parliament decided that this was a direction which had to be given, then the jury manual would be amended, and it's then sent out to the whole judiciary in amended form. I may have missed something.
Well, yes, you said basically earlier on that the law was moving and things were changing in relation particularly to sexual cases. I mean, women would say that the progress is glacial, I have to say. I'm trying to understand at what point someone is able to suggest that perhaps you refer to it as judicial knowledge, yes? So that would make its way into a model direction, would it?
If it was judicial knowledge, it would enable a judge to give a direction, because there would then be no fear that there was no lack of evidential base, because judicial knowledge is basically a statement of things that are universally acceptable, like the basic rules of mathematics or geography. So that if Parliament said these are facts that are judicial knowledge, that means the judge does not have to worry about giving the jury a direction which has no evidential base. He or she would be able to state that without fear of contradiction.
Okay, so that's a separate.
Ask why this particular was not in the jury manual. Yeah. I understand, having spoken to the Judicial Institute, who tend to deal with these, that it was put on hold. This is not criticism, but when the consultation document came out, this area was left to see what was going to happen. Maybe we should have proceeded to develop model directions at that point.
I suppose that it had not until then ever been in people's awareness that there perhaps should be model directions for that. That's what I'm trying to get at. How do judges or the people in charge of the jury manual say we need to update thinking? Judicial manual.
Not the jury manual.
Sorry, judicial manual.
It's called the jury manual.
Is it really? Yes. Sorry, I beg your pardon. Yes. I drifted there, sorry.
No, the this area has been under contemplation for some time, in the sense that the amendment to the 1995 Act, which enabled the Crown to lead evidence, which was it 2004? I think it was the amendment was made, was because of the same conceptions that we have now, that some jury members may think may have a preconception. Therefore, let's allow the Crown to lead evidence, which would previously probably have been regarded as inadmissible, because it's really evidence directly about somebody's credibility, which we tend to exclude as collateral. So the thing has been under contemplation, it may be that we should have followed the English line sooner and got some model directions out. I accept that.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just to tell you one piece of information, because I had the benefit of hearing from the director of the Judicial Institute very recently. The jury manual has very recently gone online for the first time exclusively, and it's no longer, it used to be published on an annual basis, as Lord Carlaby correctly says. My understanding is that means that it's continually updated now, and when something happens, a decision from the High Court or whatever, or a recommendation, then that's something that's just a continuing process because it's online and it's easier to do that.
Sorry, there's a little debate going on here about judicial knowledge and jury manuals, which we'll save for later. And next have Roderick, followed by Margaret. I think it's Margaret McDougall, yes.
Morning, panel. Most of my questions have been answered, but I just wanted to put something to you that was suggested in our evidence session by Mr. Meehan, representing effective advocates. He said if matters were in the jury manual, would still be a danger that there would be a direction on which no evidence had been led. Do you think that is a real danger?
Yes. Until one, I understand that, although I don't have the precise name of the case, that south of the border, where there are model directions, there have been instances, or at least an instance, where the judge has gone off piste, so to speak, and given a direction which is a little further than that, and that has been criticised as not having an evidential base. But somebody could, people are quite capable of challenging the jury manual directions as not being correct in law, or there could be a challenge on the basis that a particular direction in the jury manual did not have an evidential base in fact. So it is a possibility. We would have to decide whether that was well founded or not. Does that answer?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
He's basically saying that if this was not statutory and was just simply in the jury manual, is it possible that, say, a conviction was overturned because a judge had given a direction which was in the jury manual but did not have an evidential base? And the answer to that is, well, possibly. But because from time to time we do get challenges to the contents of the jury manual, because it's not law, it's guidance.
Thank you. He also went on to discuss the question of what would happen if there were mandatory directions in this area, that would set a precedent, and in the absence of jury research, he wasn't sure whether the jury would find that helpful, if there was a pressure to be considered across the board. What view do you take about the precedent issue, and would jury research assist as obviously we're now embarking on an era of jury research?
Well, the Cabinet Secretary, I don't think, has given us the full scope of the proposed research, but this would be an obvious area, certainly, in which to see if the research carried out by Professor Munro and her colleague is correct's not quite the right word, but is valid. I'm not quite sure how to answer your question.
I'm trying to set the distinction between valid and correct.
the point that this would be an ideal area for jury research. But yeah, in terms of it, just set it on its own, setting a precedent is, if we were to proceed with mandatory directions.
Well, that's the sort of general constitutional yeah. position, which I was anxious not to, yeah. Not to say that we were, Mr. Finney's comments in relation to whether we got we resented it or got upset. Yes, it does set a precedent, because obviously if there is a Parliament is dictating what should be said to juries by a judge in this area, then no doubt in other areas other people may seek to extend that and wish other directions to be given, which is where we get into the constitutional divide.
Okay, thank you.
By that, I take it, the concerns that becomes politicians, the very, very clear and important line between the judiciary and politicians will have been breached.
Yes.
And that's not good news, is it?
No, well, we would not think so. It would... mutual respect is a very important thing, which I think we have in this jurisdiction.
And would it not be important also to retain the tensions between the judiciary and the politicians, tensions that are useful for democracy? Would you subscribe to that?
I would. The balance is very important, that there remains that form of tension, as long as it doesn't drift into resentment.
Oh, I'm not. I wasn't suggesting that for a moment. What's your view on that, Sheriff? I have concerns. I mean, obvious from what I'm saying, I have concerns about this section.
I agree entirely with what Lord Carling has said on this, that these tensions are important and that the distinction is important. And once I tend to think of things in terms of if there's a clear and defined line and it's crossed, quite often the line then disappears when you look back and it's gone.
Margaret.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, panel. I wish to ask questions around sexual risk orders. And one of the features of the sexual risk order is that in the bill, as introduced, the order may be imposed on a person who has not been convicted of any offence, but who has done an act of a sexual nature. And an act of sexual nature is not defined in the bill. So could the panel perhaps give me their understanding of what an act of a sexual nature is as provided in the bill?
It's not something which the judges have expressed any views on. We regarded this as primarily a matter of policy for yeah. Parliament, and we really did not have any views on it at all. It was something that was entirely a matter for Parliament to determine, and we would address it in a given case. But I'm sorry I can't help further than that, but we just thought this was policy.
Okay. Could I... Well, maybe you won't wish to answer any of the questions around this then, because it's not in your...
it's that we didn't think it was a... We thought we were straying into...
don't think for you to right. comment.
Okay. So, are you concerned about the fact that sexual risk orders could be imposed on an individual who has not committed any offence? Yes.
It's not something we've regarded as... The judges have not made any comment on the validity or otherwise of this okay. legislation on the basis that it was government policy and a matter for Parliament to rule upon rather than the judges to comment upon.
Is there an issue, however, that one of these orders can be imposed without the right of an appearance of the person to prevent it being imposed upon them? Is there any issue there under ECHR? Can you comment on that? I mean, from a legal point of view.
Well, the matter is judicially determined by the sheriff, so it would be...
It says here, I mean, looking at this, when application is made for a sexual risk order under Section 20, the person against whom the order is being sought would have the right to make or represent it before a sexual risk order is imposed. Can you clarify whether or not in a case where the application is being made for a sexual risk order under that, they do have a right not just discretionary. They have a right to address that.
That's as I understand it, yes.
They do. It's absolute.
Well, the application is to go to the sheriff. I don't think I'm in a position to address this particular section of the bill. It's not something which I thought I was going to be asked about.
I phrased it wrongly. Long day. It's a procedural matter under section 26. If I read it through, it says it doesn't actually say. If I'm reading it, I'm maybe reading it too quickly. That procedurally, the party has a right to appear before the sheriff. Am I right or wrong? It just says in subsection 2, an appropriate sheriff may make a sexual risk or only if satisfied respondent has done an act of a sexual nature, etc. And then it goes on, it doesn't at any point say that the party has a right to be heard.
Well, it's not something that I've applied my mind to, and it would be something which we may be called upon to rule upon if there is a problem of that nature.
Yes.
Obviously, Parliament has obtained the usual certificate about ECHR compliance, and it would depend on the procedural rules that were surrounded this.
There's a right of appeal, but it seems that it would be better if you had an opportunity at the first hearing to make a representation rather than go through appellate procedure. Yeah.
I mean, these replace existing forms of order, the sexual harm orders.
And my last question then, as I see, Margaret, are you? Please do,
If they were able to comment then on the reasons for the very low numbers of RSHOs which have been granted by the courts in Scotland to date.
I cannot comment on that. I've done no research at all on that matter. I'm terribly sorry, but I was not anticipating answering questions on Chapter 4 of the bill for the reasons that we regarded this as a matter of policy.
That's a matter for the court, surely.
Yeah.
I'm afraid I
Professor,
can't.
Did I call you Professor?
I thought I could hang on to that for a while. I'm really sorry, there's nothing I can add to that. I didn't come prepared for this sort of question, and again we thought that it was policy and something therefore that we shouldn't even comment on.
If you want us to take this away and think about whether we can make a comment, I'd be happy to do that and write in if there's
if you feel appropriate.
Yes.
Can I just ask a final question? I'm probably going to regret asking it, as I've already muddled up with professors and whatnot. How does something become judicial knowledge, and how do we know that it's judicial knowledge?
Judicial knowledge is something which grows over time. So there are certain things that you don't have to prove, and such as the fact that there's a railway between Edinburgh and Glasgow and things like that.
Basic stuff.
Yeah, it's basic stuff which which everybody ought to know, and it's accepted as fact.
So the fact that somebody doesn't report something of a sexual nature for a period of time, for a longer period of time, is that judicial knowledge? Does that fall into that category that you say it could be a month, it could be years? Would that be just the fact that sometimes in general happens, that's judicial knowledge as well, just like the railway line?
I would personally, I think that the propositions which are contained in the bill may well be judicial knowledge, because I do not think what is stated is controversial as a matter of fact. I think what is stated is correct, and therefore, in that sense, it is judicial knowledge. I don't think necessarily every member of the judiciary would share that view. Now, it goes back to how confident you feel about stating things to juries with no evidential base.
So judicial knowledge isn't shared by all judges?
Well, it ought to be shared by all judges, but it depends. There comes a point where, say, a principle of of mathematics becomes something which is requires expert evidence, and exactly where that line is drawn. You may know there's a railway line between Edinburgh and Glasgow, but you might not necessarily know the composition of the points at Winchborough. It's a matter of degree as to what is or is not within the knowledge of people.
I knew I didn't want to ask that question. I've asked it. I'm going to thank you very much. I have to go on because we've got much more to do. Can I thank you very much for a very intriguing evidence session, some of it quite pithy, as I'm allowed to use that word now, as you've defined it for us, Lord Carloway. Thank you very much, and I'll just suspend for a couple of minutes, allow the witnesses to leave.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. On. It's consideration of four negative instruments. The first is the Sheriff Appeal Court Fees Order 2015, SSI 2015/379. It sets out those persons who are exempt from paying fees and specific fees exemptions relating to particular proceedings. The DPLR committee did not draw any concerns on the instrument to our attention. Do you have any comments? Are members content to make no recommendation in relation to this instrument? The second negative instrument being considered is the Civil Legal Aid Scotland Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2015, SSI 2015/380. This adapts the framework and arrangements and existing legal aid regulations to accommodate the changes coming into force in January 2016 relating to civil proceedings in the new Sheriff Appeal Court. Again, the DPL committee did not draw any concerns on the instrument to our attention. You'll see from your papers with a couple of written submissions on this instrument and a late submission to the Faculty of Advocates, which has been tabled. Do members have any comments on the instrument? No. I beg your pardon, Reg, you'll need to move fast. Yes.
To refer to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates, I find it a wee bit concerning, but I don't understand the full time scale. But I think the faculty's point is that the regulation which is now before us for consideration is not the regulation that they saw previously. And I think the government's comment on the matter is dated at the beginning of November. So my understanding of the timetable is this is all very unfortunate.
Well, I think it's very unfortunate for the faculty as well, who could pay more attention to what we are doing. And it's not that they're without sufficient legal brains around to come back to the committee sooner rather than later. So I'm moving on. Are members content? I beg your pardon? No, it's on the record now, and I think you're content just to leave it at that. Thank you. Are members content with no recommendation in relation to the instrument, right? Third negative instrument is the Scottish Tribunal's Eligibility for Appointment Regulations 2015, SSI 2015/381. This creates eligibility criteria for ordinary and legal members of the first tier tribunal and legal members of the upper tribunal. Again, the DPLR committee did not draw any concerns on the instrument to our attention. Do you have any comments? Are you content to make no recommendation? The fourth and final negative instrument is the Act of Sederunt Fees of Solicitors in the Sheriff Appeal Court 2015, SSI 2015/387. This regulates the taxation of accounts of expenses between parties in relation to proceedings in the Sheriff Appeal Court. Again, the DPLR committee did not draw any concerns on the instrument to our attention. Do you have any comments?
No.
Are you alive? Yes. Are members content to make no recommendation in relation to this instrument? No recommendation. Thank you. We now move into private session. Thank you.